Okay.
So this time is going to be the seminar of Sebastián Pedraza. He's going to tell us about...
My name is there.
The name of Sebastián here. And he's going to talk about this ATLAS from collision to a single thought that is related with what Sebas is doing in during his PhD and his stages in at CERN. So...
Okay, so well... Thanks to Roberto for inviting me to give this talk. I will, well, it's Friday afternoon. I will try to be a little bit quick giving this talk. So this is the outline, okay? This talk is split in two halves, okay? The first one is I'm going to show you the data path from the interaction point to the final data that is useful for to do the all the analysis at ATLAS. So I will describe a little bit all the data streams, what is doing in the calibration loop, the bulk reconstruction, and then after that, what we have is the DPDs that the DPDs are the samples we use for the analysis. And after that, well, I will show a brief report of my analysis. I will not show any results, but I will show you a little bit of what I'm doing. So, well, the data streams. Talk about the data streams is talk about the ATLAS trigger. So at the LHC, the collision rate is 40 megahertz for bunch spacing of 25 nanoseconds. In every 25 nanoseconds, we have the collisions, and on top of each signal event, we have more or less 20 pileup events. But this data is for 2012, so for run two, this will be higher. So we cannot store everything, so we have to reduce that rate from 40 megahertz to a rate of 200 hertz in an unbiased and efficient way. And the way we do is using the triggers, okay? The events are stored in different streams. The streams are collection of data that they are defined with a dedicated trigger menu. So these are the three ones. The stream that is important to the data analysis is the FISIC stream. That is also splitting in different substreams, like the E-gamma, J-tau ETMs, and so on, muons. Then these are two special streams that they are used to control the detector, the calibrations, and spot some failure in the data taking. That is the calibration. I don't know. Wait. Sorry. That is the calibration and the express steering. This one is dedicated to the data quality and monitoring, and contain just up to 4% of a FISIC stream data. So what we have is to classify these streams, what we have is an event. This event and pass through the level one trigger. That this trigger is implemented in the hardware and takes the information from the calorimeters and the muon and the muon chamber. If the event has some physics interest, pass through the level two. And then the level two is the one that classifies the and split the data to the different streams. The streams are inclusive, so this means that the same event can appear in more than one stream. So there is duplicated events when you look all the streams, but at the end in the analysis you don't have this. We are able to remove this duplicity and so on. So this is the data flow. In this blue box is all the things that are done at CERN. So this red box is what is done in the point one. This is in the ATLAS control room. So once the detector starts to record again the collisions in this year, what will happen is from the express stream, we will check the collisions as they are being recorded in data, and all the people in the control room that they are the DQ shifter and other system shifters. Okay, I think I took this picture from a DQ guy, so he forgot about all the rest of people that they are in the control room, and with this is the first the first point when we can spot some failure of the detector, and this is it's a crucial task to be there, because any failure can produce the loss of data, and that's not the purpose. The purpose is to have the detector fully operative to get the maximum data for that the LHC is providing to the detectors. So as I said, the express stream is processed with a delay of minutes after the collisions are established. So, as I said, these streams allow to the different online shifter to spot the detector failures. For example, mask noisy calorimeter cells or pixel channels, and this will help to have a good data collection. Then, the second, once the run is finished, okay, all the streams pass to the calibration loop. Well, not all the streams, just the calibration and the express streams go to the calibration loop. So with the express stream, people from data quality will check more or less globally the quality of the data. And with the calibration stream, the different combined performance or subdetectors people will check and calibrate all the modules, and after this calibration, they will provide an update on the conditions of the detector that they will be used to recover some data that is loose or spot some failure. And this task that is very important because after that all the data will pass for all the data will be available for the analysis have to be done in 48 hours. Okay, we cannot any delay in this step will delay a lot the production of all the data for the analyzers. So in the calibration loop is once the run is finished, the data of the calibration express streams go to the calibration loop. This cycle is take up to 48 hours, where all the experts have to check the detector. They will have to update the condition database with a complete picture of the detector and the calibrations. And for example, at IFIC, we develop some tools for the ID alignment, and we have to be able to run the alignment algorithm within this, once the beam spot is determined, and be able to spot any misalignment and fix it within the 84 hours window. For example, here, this is, for example, in this pass, once the first check within the calibration or the express stream, we can spot here a hot channel in the calorimeter. So this the calorimeter expert will mask this channel and update the database, and after that we will have this channel will disappear and this will and this is a good well and we'll fix that that problem, giving a better data for the next steps.
This is done each 48 hours. I mean, it takes 48. I mean, all this data in 48 hours, they kind of calibrate to remove the pixel or something like this.
Yeah, because these two streams are very small. They contains up to 4% of the data from the physics streams. We cannot do this using the physics streams because they are very huge. They take days to be processed. So that's why we use these two smaller pieces. And for example, for the calibration, there are different streams. For the alignment, we use the ID, the calibration ID tracks. That is just a set of data with high quality tracks that allow us to align the detector. We don't need the other information. We don't need the calorimeters or whatever. Just the hits and tracks in the inner detector. And yes, and all of that have to be this. If the problem is if we can recover this kind of failures, have to be done in 48 hours. If not, these problems will be put in a database, and for the analyzers, we have one thing that is called the good run list. That is like it's a list where is said which Lumi block is good or not, or which region is we don't have to check the data on that part. And after that, after some months of the data taking, we will try to recover all the problems. So and this is, for example, one tool here for the alignment. This is the 2012 data. This plot is showing the translations in the x axis of the inner detector each subdetector, the pixel, SET barrel end caps, TRT barrel and end caps. So with this tool, we will see if the detector is moving after each run, and with this we will take the decision of if we have to update the database or not. And for example, here is showing this is the period B. All the runs from period B, and you can see here the detector's move was drifting basically almost all these runs. And after this we take the decision of update the alignment constants, and after that, and you can see that after that the detector was we could stabilize the ID. So I don't know how many time passed between these two between all these range, because here is plotted run by run, so maybe three of these points or four were taken in the same day. I don't remember, but what you can see here is that after the decision of update the databases, all the next run were fine. For example, this region correspond to this one. Here, change the period, the period C. And between period C, B and C, there was a technical stop. They changed a few things. For example, here, the biggest changes are every time the solenoid is switched off and on, basically. So, well, once the run is finished, once the calibration and express stream pass the calib loop, start the processing of the processing of all the physics streams, and as I said, this can take several days. That's why we have dedicated streams for the calibration and the data quality. For example, here I'm showing the huge amount of data the shifters online in the point one, and then offline in their home institutes or also at CERN have to check. You can see the number of channels the different SIPS system have. Okay, for example, for pixels they have 80 million channels. These are the calorimeter, channels for the calorimeters, the muons. And as you can see, the efficiency, at least the 95% of all the channels were operational. That is really good number for this huge detector. And here you can see the efficiency, the recording efficiency for each day. That is, the mean is 93% of efficiency, very high.
And these blank regions?
These are stops in the data taking. For example, this is the period A. Here stops there was a technical stop, so there was no collisions there. Now I started again the LHC, and so all these spikes are because of that. We don't have collisions there. So after processing the data, once the data goes to this place, and is available for all the analyzers. We have to make some different outputs to more human friendly for the analyzers. Okay, so from the raw data, we'll reconstruct all the events, and the first output is the ESD, the event summary data, that contains a lot of information of the detector that is not needed, for example, by me. I don't need the number of hits and so on, or where the hits are in a module. From the DHD, we produce the AOD. This one is a summary of the physical objects we have in the events. So here we can start to make some analysis, but the samples are still very big. Okay, they are not I cannot have all the samples I need in my laptop using this kind of and I don't know if here at IFIC, yes, because it's a tier two, but I cannot handle with this in my, for example, in my laptop, or if my home institute has no enough resources, I will need some skimming on this data. So the ones that the output that we really use is the DPDs, okay, that is derived physics data. And here we have the collection of just electrons, muons, so on. We don't have any information of the detector. And for example, this is the list of different samples I have to use in my analysis. As you can see, the data is just electrons, muons, but for Monte Carlo there are more Monte Carlo than data. And and we have to check, well, use different generators and different showerings to see what's the best combination that fits better in our case. So okay, with this, I finished this part, and now is I will talk about my analysis. So what I'm doing is I'm analyzing the single top events, and what I want to do is to probe the WTB vertex and check if there are some anomalous couplings in the production or the decay of the top. So this is the Lagrangian that we used to describe the WTB. So if we can measure some observables that related with the couplings, and we can see that they are not zero, we can start to think that there are some non-standard model physics in this case. But we are, for example, in my analysis, I'm not using any model. It's just a model independent way. So the goal is to probe the WTB vertex by measuring the polarization of the top and of the top quark and the W boson. So what we can do is to measure the W helicity fractions, but this is already done. But in single top production, the top quark is highly polarized, so there is a preferred direction in space. So with using this feature, we can define new observables that are more sensitive to these couplings than the helicity fractions. So here is what I do is to take the final objects in the decay, that is the lepton here, the light quark, and the spin of the top. The spin of the top is the spin of the top goes along the same. Oh, no, sorry. Here, this is the momentum of the W. Okay, this is not the light quark. This is what I take is the momentum of the lepton, the momentum of the W, and the top spin. And the top spin goes in the same direction as the spectator quark for single top events. So from here, this is using the Lagrangian. This is the distributions are truth level at generator level. So this is what I expect the shapes of the different angular distribution I want to measure. But shapes, I will extract the polarizations and the helicity fractions using the different projections in this frame. For example, using the momentum of the lepton and the W and the momentum of the W, this theta star. With that, I can measure the helicity fractions. If I make a projection on this plane, I can measure or the normal polarization fraction or the transverse or the transverse one, depending on the axis I'm taking. And also, well, I can measure the, well, I cannot measure exactly the polarization of the top. What I measure is alpha p, where alpha is the analyzer power of the lepton in the case where I'm using the lepton to define this angle. So I have to make some cuts in the collection of events I have in order to enhance the T-channel events in my final collections. So first, what I do is use standard cuts within the single top group. This is done in order to cross-check with other people if we have the same event yields and we don't have anything wrong there. And you can see, well, the different process that participate in my in my region of interest. And after that, I apply four extra cuts to finally select the events. And for example, here, applying these four cuts, you can see that the four electrons and muons, I have a signal to background ratio of 1.2. So this is more than the 50% of all the final events are T-channel events. So
what does it mean, the E-channel, new channel? Is
the electron
number,
channel,
the number of events that
the, it, what yeah. this no yeah, the numbers. Electron channel
yeah, what?
And muon channel
yeah,
and this
the,
is
the numbers that are down
is the number of T-channel events I have in for electrons and for muons.
Ah.
Yeah, this is the number of events that pass these cuts. Yeah. And these are the numbers that pass the final, well, this one plus these four, these extra four cuts. So also, well, in every analysis, you have to define some control regions to check if the Monte Carlo is modeling properly the data you are taking. So in this case, we define two control regions, one that we call high mass control region, that is after these cuts we apply this extra cut on the reconstructed top mass, and the other control region is the TT bar one. So with this, what do we do is we apply these preselection levels with these preselection cuts, but in this case we require four jets instead of two, and with this we enhance the amount of TT bar events in the selection, and the well and also the purpose of, well, to check if your Monte Carlo is modeling properly the data, and well, to extract some information from here, the contribution of the signal has to be very low. So here you can see that the signal to background ratio is just 3% with the amount of T-channel events in this control region is negligible. So now here are some plots at preselection level. This is the eta of the B-jet, the PT of the lepton. These are for the electron channels, these two for muon channel. So at preselection we have good data Monte Carlo agreement. This is the high mass control region. You can see, for example, here at preselection we have the amount of T-channel is not negligible, but here disappear the blue boxes. And as you can see in the high mass control region, the two main backgrounds are W plus jets and TT bar, and this one that is just TT bar background. And in, for example, in the three regions, we have good agreement data Monte Carlo for these variables. And finally, well, this is at selection level, the same observables, and you can see that these kinematics variables are fine and in good agreement with data. So, well, after that, once I see if my Monte Carlo is modeling properly the data, and well, and make some checks and so on, this is the observables I really use, and from the and the ones that where I extract I will extract all the observables I want to measure. Here, for example, I'm showing the cosine of theta. Well, we call it theta star. Well, theta x. So from these distributions, we can extract the alpha p of the top. But the, well, these plots are at preselection level. They are not at selection. Because, well, I cannot show that. From these two distributions that we call cosine of theta star, is where I extract the W boson helicity fractions. And this one, this is the normal, and this is the cosine of theta n and theta t, where I extract the polarization, the normal polarization fraction, the transverse one. And for example, from here, I can extract this asymmetry, the forward backward, the normal forward backward asymmetry, that this really sensitive to non anomalous couplings because it's proportional to the imaginary part, you know, from this Lagrangian. Is proportional to the imaginary part of GR, and GR is zero in the standard model. So well, once we have all these plots at the all the distribution at selection level, we define the measurement method. In my case, is in my case what I do is well, is an unfold of the data using the one, well, one method, well, one algorithm that is called iterative Bayesian method to unfold. After the unfolding is when I unfold, what I'm doing is go to the reconstructed level, well, to the reconstructed objects, to the Parton level, and in the Parton level is where I have to measure all these things. Okay, so the measurement of the fits of the polarizations and asymmetries are done with a chi-square fit or just measuring the asymmetries by counting the events. And that's all. And then, well, the most important thing and the part where all the people spend the biggest part of its time is just computing the systematics uncertainties and so on. And for example, I'm here, I'm showing some expected uncertainties on the different observables that the well, this table is a little bit old, but well, we will try to make these uncertainties as low as possible. And well, that's all. Because that's all from my side.
So, questions? Questions?
Comments?
About the cars? You thinking that on these cars, this is because you want a region with a less background, right?
Yes.
So, but how you decide to put this?
No, well, these ones are standard ones for all the people that is working on the anti-channel events. They don't reject a lot of background. So this one is to have a good set of data. And then, well, in our case, we apply for extra cuts, but there are other people that use after.
Once you have the data.
What?
Right, once you see the data that you.
No, no. Well, these cuts are decided using with Monte Carlo studies. No, all of this work is done using Monte Carlo.
But this signal preselection are cuts that also are used in other studies that are not with top or any other studies.
No, in single top.
This is only for single top, but like to make a big filter and then you make some more specific cuts for.
Yeah, or apply a neural network or whatever. In our case, we apply just. Well, it's a cut-based analysis, but the other groups, they use the neural network to this, after this step, after the preselection, to make the real selection.
And then they compare the different groups?
Well, compare two analyses with a neural network is very difficult. Well, if the neural net is the same, it's not a... such a big problem, but if you are using different neural networks, it's not easy to compare exactly the yields, because also, well, it depends on the analysis what you want to measure, because at the beginning we try to use a neural net, but a neural net trained by a group of Wuppertal, but the variables they use to define their neural network is very sensitive to, in our case, for is very sensitive to the anomalous couplings. In our case, they measure the cross sections, and so they don't care about, for example, how to build this axis, and the but the we for example if maybe we using a neural net with those variables, we are biasing the final objects, and this frame will be more standard model-like than the ones we want.
I have a question about in the beginning when you have this flow, this part that is conditional database online and Oracle Stream, where you store all the data from?
No, this is store all the information about the detector, temperatures of the modules, which modules are dyed or not, which are noisy, the calibration of the different components, the alignment constants. Is all related with the machine, not data. So this one, the condition database online, is the one that knows everything about all the pieces of the detector, and is the one that is used to make this, the first step
in the control room.
Yeah, in the control room. And then, after that, in the calibration loop, if we can improve some calibration stuff, we will update the condition database. So for the next run, we update the condition database, and for the next run, we'll be here again. And this is
that stuff that is Oracle, because the company, or is just a funny name for the.
No, I think it's because this database is ATLAS is using Oracle.
For the database.
Oracle technology. No
open source database.
For that, I think that they are using Oracle, but I don't know if they will change for run 2, or I don't know. Yeah, because this part is because the data, the raw data, the bias streams, are as they is the as they are from the different modules, and they will be stored forever, and and all the improvements the and the calibration and so on will be related with this with the condition database. So it's like it's if well in 20 years we want to well we can make a really big improvement. What we have to make is to change the condition database, not the data.
Ah, okay.
So it's like well they have to be sure that the everything will be will work or. I don't know, but maybe that's the reason.
Yeah, so you can kind of recalibrate the data from the past with new advance that you're going to have in the future.
Yeah, all the calibration and so on is stored here. And I think it's because, well, in, if in 20 years they need something.
They find a bug in the
They pay the Oracle guys and the Oracle guys will fix it.
More questions? If not, we thank Sebas for the seminar. And I guess we have the next student seminar in 2 weeks.